prepare the cast for the film, we decided to send them off to boot camp for a training sequence, and that was in Kopaska.
Try to really, really take in as much as you can, right? The information from them and really, really pay attention to everything, okay?
Kita siapkan segalanya, karena film ini cerita tentang pasukan khusus. Akhirnya kita harus kirim sekitar 8 orang pemeran pasukan khusus. Kita kirim ke Kopaska, Tanjung Priuk, pasukan khas Katak, Angkatan Laut.
Kita naik tronton. Pas sampai sana, nyet langsung, dar, masuk garis garis batas udah militer, itu udah sebagai siswa mereka.
Kap! Jalan! Oke!
Pas kita pertama sampai pun, istirahat, kita belum sempat istirahat, sampai kita langsung ganti pakaian, ganti baju-baju sama telana-telana training supaya kita buat latihan lari pagi segala macam. Tidur 30 menit itu pun kurang cukup buat kita. Cara ngebangunin pun beda, itu dengan senapan.
Untuk dilatih bagaimana cara menggunakan senjata, bagaimana disiplin militer, bagaimana berkomunikasi dengan sesama anggota maupun pimpinan.
Aduh, 3-1. Nah, sebatang ini nih, 3-1 ini. Kagak mati nih.
They learned all the sort of different techniques for like strategy and how to control people in different environments. Then about raid simulations as well.
Ah, ini bisa kena buah. Langsung tembak dong. Kalau begini, main begitu, lo.
Kita waktu itu belajar skibi. Jadi ada beberapa teknik penyerbuan ke dalam gedung. Beregu, tapi ada aturan-aturan beberapa tempat kita naik, tapi di situ ada yang dijaga.
Kalau 7 orang ya, 1, 1, 1, 3, 4 orang sana. 4 orang sana.
Ada beberapa attitude yang kita dapat di situ. Oh, ternyata nggak sembarangan kita bawa senapan ataupun dengan senapan yang kosong. Misalnya ada beberapa kita cara nembak senapan, laras panjang, laras pendek, dan melempar granat. Itu pengalaman yang belum pernah saya alamin seumur hidup saya.
We want them to learn everything they could about the weapons they were going to use in the film, so that they wouldn't look like amateurs. They wouldn't look like they'd never picked up a gun before. But also to establish a sense of brotherhood amongst them as a group. To get them having like a working relationship and to rely upon each other like they would in real life. So that was really important part of the boot camp then, not just for the technical side of the training, but also to build bonds between them as well. I was always more interested to combine lots of different martial arts styles into this film. I didn't want to have it just silat versus silat all the time. That can kind of get very boring very quickly if you have all the fighters and all the sort of good guys and bad guys all using the same martial arts discipline.
Dari semua jurus-jurus, dari semua gerakan-gerakan koreo yang kita buat, memang banyak ada bilang, oh ini mirip Muay, ini mirip karate. Dari semua style, itu ada beberapa perbedaan. Pak Yan pernah bilang, tubuh orang ini nggak ada yang beda. Tangan dan sikut, kaki dan lutut. Gitu. Kita pukul dengan tangan, kita sikut pakai sikut, kita tendang pakai kaki. Tapi ada beberapa sebelum kita melakukan gerakan tersebut, kita punya proses gitu.
Okay,
come further in guys, you're actually too far up frame. You go move back. Okay, stop. Okay. Right, start from there, yeah?
Akhiran yang kita lakukan dengan gerakan koreo tersebut tetap kita dengan style dengan silat, dengan liukan-liukannya, elastis-elastis tubuh kita gitu, dengan karakternya itu benar-benar kental kita kembangkan dari untuk silat.
Ya, saya ya. Oke ya. Good.
Yuk, pas ngambil dua kali itu sampai
itu berapa ngambil itu berapa? Ya, grab it
di setiap scene fighting yang jelas ini semuanya sangat berbeda.
Action!
Dalam melakukan fighting, Iko tidak menunggu satu orang maju selesai, satu orang maju tidak, tapi berapa orang pun sampai melawan 18 orang lebih itu semuanya bisa maju dan bergerak, jadi tidak kelihatan gerakan Iko menunggu itu bukan trik kamera, karena memang kita setting teknik fightingnya seperti itu. Dan saya sendiri sangat percaya karena ini diperankan oleh Iko, di mana dia seorang atlet silat, jadi karakter Iko itu akan mewakili betul-betul karakter silat.
For our films, what we tend to do is just as a sort of as a backup option, as a failsafe, is that we shoot video storyboard for the entire fight scene in pre-production. And what that helps me do is see how the fight is structured, see how it comes together in the edit, and then make decisions on what angles need to change, what parts of the choreography need to change before we get to production. So what happens in pre-production is we design the fight scene from beginning to end. So we look for every possible flaw and every possible positive that we can find in terms of the scene. And we try to polish it then as best as we can before production.
Satu gedung tua, kumuh, dan terkesan kusam, lembab, gelap. Gak mudah kita dapetin lokasi real seperti itu, jadi akhirnya harus kita bangun detail lokasi yang benar-benar seperti apa yang kita mau dan cocok sama koreografi kita.
Sometimes the choreography will end up dictating to us how the set design needs to be. We might have certain ideas in choreography which takes place like 2 or 3 months before pre-production starts. And we'll have specific ideas of movements and falls which demand that we need like certain props or certain structures for the rooms.
And action!
As a result of that then, when we discuss with our art designer Morty, we'll take all the choreography and then let him know the layout of the room.
Yang kita mau itu kita bisa wujudkan sesuai dengan jalannya skenario yang kita bikin. Kalau yang asli, kita nggak bisa rubah-rubah menjadi apa yang kita mau. Jadi menyesuaikan lokasinya gitu.
Teknik pengambilan gambar di film The Raid, kita coba dengan teknik semi-dokumenter. Bergerak cepat, tapi tidak terlalu stabil, tidak menggunakan steadicam.
For Subur Maud, I knew we wanted to go more handheld style, but I still wanted to stick to HD. Purely because when we do the fight sequences and the action sequences, we go through so many takes that, you know, if we were using film, we'd waste so much product, basically. And we were looking at new cameras on the market, different things that were coming out, and the new Panasonic AF100 caught our eye a lot.
Kemudian kita tambahkan free grip di situ, supaya pergerakannya bisa lebih dinamis tapi tidak terlalu banyak goyang.
Very effective. We've had the cameras on fig rigs, so we can kind of do some more controlled movements. It's not quite so bumpy and handheld, and it gives us the freedom and flexibility to really move the camera around a lot during the scene and change position and change angles a lot.
Same again, this time shifting forward again. Yeah, it's supposed to come forward last time. There you go.
For Subuh Maut, the lighting is a lot more atmospheric than it was in Merantau. In this movie, we're kind of going for a much more sort of noirish look. So we got a lot more shadows, a lot more darker locations. And because it's all interior, it means that we've been, and because the camera moves around 180 degrees a lot, we've been looking for different ways to be able to light with mobile lights, basically. So what we're doing is picking up LED lights that we can put on booms and we can follow and track along with the characters and be able to be much more flexible with our camera movement as well.
Konsep makeupnya secara keseluruhan sebenarnya nggak ada yang spesial, karena dia mau terlihat realistis, terlihat sangat natural gitu. Tapi ada yang spesial ketika efek kita bermain dengan efek-efek atau efek luka, dilihat dari faktor penyebab luka itu sendiri, apakah karena tembakan atau karena senjata tajam.
Lihat atas banget ya, atas banget, atas.
Untuk efek tembakan yang kita pakai di Dread ini juga butuh banyak eksperimen, karena sudah cukup lama di Indonesia itu tidak ada film yang menggunakan special effect. Jadi kita agak kesulitan mencari kru yang punya keahlian di bidang itu. Hajar habis, tembak habis di tampilan depannya. Akhirnya kita coba berkali-kali eksperimen, berkali-kali seperti apa efek yang kita pingin, sampai akhirnya kita dapat seperti apa yang kita mau, dan kita combine dengan CG, jadi nggak semuanya dengan special effect, tapi ada juga yang komputer grafik. Red Van ini jadi satu cerita yang seru juga, karena dalam budget kita menyiapkan angka untuk menyewa, bukan membeli atau membuat. Dan akhirnya karena harus menekan budget, kita beli truk bekas, kita modifikasi seperti yang kita mau. Juga kapasitas pasukan khusus di belakang yang berjumlah 18 orang harus cukup di situ. Dan ketika syuting seringkali mesinnya nyadat, mogok, jadi kita harus dorong untuk berkali-kali saat syuting.
Sixth floor, they get spotted, and then that's kind of where the film takes off then, with them coming under attack and being hunted by every gang and every criminal on every floor of the building.
Nggak ada yang berpikir dua kali, semua harus fokus satu pikiran. Nggak, soalnya satu kesalahan kecil pun fatal akibatnya.
And action!
Tungguin Markas, Kak. Kita masih bisa berada di sini.
Enggak.
adegan tembak-tembakan antara gangster menggunakan AK-47 di lantai atas menembak habis pasukan khusus di lantai seberang di bawahnya. Itu juga kita harus bangun set khusus karena nggak mungkin dilakukan di lokasi yang asli.
We do the shot pointing down at the dart being fired, all of them will be firing down as well. They'll all kind of change tension because these guys are dead now, so they don't know how we're shooting down. So once that guy gets to the shoulder, boom, he fires out. Then when we cut to the shoulder, he's firing down, but then the other guys are kind of firing down as well.
Itu ada gedung kosong tapi tidak ada atrium seperti ini atau bisa dibilang courtyard atau balkon ya, balkon dalam. Jadi kita bikin courtyard ini dua lantai. Sebenarnya nantinya courtyard ini mau di CG menjadi 15 lantai malah.
Oke, okay.
Yunggo.
In Maranto, everything was much more slower paced than the start. We had to kind of build our drama and our story before we got to the conflict, before we got to the action. And I guess to a certain extent in Maranto, we took maybe a bit too long to get to the conflict and a bit too long to get to the action. Sebuah Maut was designed purely to be a full-on action film. And so I kind of cut to the chase a lot faster than this one.
Untuk hold drop lebih spesial lagi ya, karena kita butuh dua lantai. Jadi ada satu lantai yang kita buat lubang untuk nanti melintas si pasukannya terjun ke bawah. Sementara itu nggak mungkin kita lakukan di lokasi yang asli kan, karena kita harus melubangi satu lantai. Jadi kita harus cari studio yang mempunyai ketinggian seperti apa yang kita mau. Sementara studio hampir semua ketinggiannya sangat terbatas, tidak mungkin untuk membangun dua lantai plus ada satu cap lagi di bawahnya.
Coba-coba coret, pakai akhirnya kita nemuin satu bahan untuk membuat lubang itu. Tapi desain awalnya kita buat lantai dulu dengan scaffolding, terus baru kita cover dinding-dinding lantai satunya, baru lantai duanya dengan konstruksi yang kita yakini kuat untuk kurang lebih 20-an orang kayak gitu.
I've always been interested in films which are set in one location. It kind of brings up a lot of challenges to how to keep the action fresh and entertaining.
Pull out the key. You've got it. Yeah? Right? And then you've got so much control to this action. Right? Yeah?
Drugs Lab is basically a free-for-all fight. We got three different people who have three different disciplines of fighting. Eco obviously would see that. We got Eka then, who has more of a sort of taekwondo background. And then obviously Pierre Gruno, who has basically a brawling style that we kind of gave him for the choreography then.
Saya udah ngomong dulu sebelumnya dengan Garrett, jangan kasih saya fighting yang terlalu berat. Karena masalahnya saya ada cedera kaki kan.
Kita berharap penonton bisa lebih terpukau di serbuan maut. Karena memang kita buat lebih agresif, gaya komikalnya lebih muncul di sini dibanding sama Merantau yang menceritakan tentang kehidupan.
Audiences is like more like a thrill ride of a film, something that starts and then stays relentless in terms of its pace and the action from beginning to end. I love Tama's office the most. The lighting has been really nice in here and all the furniture has been really great. The CCTV background is really nice as well. And it's the closest that any of the sets have come to being exactly as I imagined them in my head when we were writing the script. So we wanted to make Tama like the boss of this building, and you know, very wealthy and a very powerful man, but also somebody who's incredibly casual and incredibly laid back. That's reflected in terms of his wardrobe design, his posture, his gestures, the way he moves is very deliberate, very slow, and the way he approaches violence is very sort of casual but cold and detached. So he makes him much more of a cold-blooded killer than anyone I've written before.
Pada saat pertama kali gue punya beberapa perbedaan dengan Om Re gitu. Cuman lama-lama dengan proses reading yang diulang-ulang gitu, komunikasi, diomongin cara pandangnya seperti apa. Lama-lama ya kita satu pandangan gitu.
Ya, untuk karakter Tama sebagai tokoh pimpinan gangster di film The Raid, kita memilih Ray Saitapi sebagai pemeran Tama. Dia begitu baik, berintonasi, karakternya begitu kuat secara pribadi, tanpa harus berdialog dia sudah bisa menyampaikan apa yang menjadi pesan dari karakter itu.
Unik buat saya belum pernah pegang tokoh seperti ini gitu loh. Dan masyarakat juga harus tahu sosok-sosok seperti ini.
Begitu agresif, begitu seru.
I wanted to create another gang that would have their own identity, that would have their own sort of like presence about them, and to really build them up to be like opponents that we look forward to see in that moment when, you know, the inevitable happens, when Nico finally gets to fight against them.
Saya dikeroyok dua. Saya fight dengan satu lawan, jadi yang satunya lagi nggak hanya diem, kayak bikin gerakan sendiri.
We do a lot of takes, and when we do the fight sequences, every take, the actors will get more and more tired. So we have to get them right up with their stamina. And so it's not just about learning the choreography and knowing what the movement is. But it's about having the right aggression, it's about having the right skill and the right speed, but it's also about stamina.
No reaction needed, because on the next shot I show the head.
Dia pengen ada adegan yang agak sadis gitu. Bukan sadis sih, artinya lebih keras lah, lebih kasar gitu. Dari situ timbul gimana coba kalau tim art bikin satu sisi dinding yang nantinya aman buat pengadeganan itu gitu.
Film martial art tentang silat, kita nggak jauh pakemnya dari silat. Tapi kalau buat untuk stylenya dari misalkan punya basic kayak Joe Taslim, dia punya basic judo, kita jangan sampai keluar dari pakemnya dia dari judo gitu. Tapi kita kasih koreo tentang tetap silat dengan endingnya stylenya dia gitu loh.
Saya pikir saya akan menambahkan gerakan di sini atau di situ. Insting, natural insting saya bahwa kalau saya pakai teknik judo saya di sini di situ. Tapi ternyata koreografi itu sendiri sudah semua pakem-pakem itu sudah ada di situ sih.
Medok itu sosok yang tidak punya nurani. Dia hidupnya hanya berdasarkan nyali, dan pola hidupnya dia sama sekali tidak takut mati. Dan itu memang cukup dibekali dengan bela diri yang memang dia seorang yang jagoan lah kadang-kadang.
Medic, please!
Film The Raid menampilkan banyak adegan action, banyak adegan pertarungan, senjata tajam, tangan kosong. Banyak menggunakan fighter, hampir 80 lebih fighter. Tapi kita juga sangat serius memikirkan bagaimana keamanan setiap adegan dalam syuting film ini.
Di sisi bela diri, kita memang menyiapkan mereka, orang-orang yang sudah memiliki bela diri. Dari tim menyediakan medik yang betul-betul udah siap gitu. Ada tim dokter, ambulan, dan segala macam. Jadi kita antisipasi semaksimal mungkin.
Terlalu dalam, Bayu.
Throughout pre-production then, as he trained and trained and trained constantly with Yayan, they reached a very good sort of trust relationship.
Pertarungan Jaka Medok di sisi karakter seorang Jaka itu pertarungan hidup mati.
Fighting ini cukup menentukan dan memang sengaja kami buat bagaimana sebuah fighting ini sehingga menjadi suatu kolaborasi antara dua jago bela diri dari bela diri yang berbeda.
Post production offline kita lakukan di sini. Garrett sendiri sebagai editor.
Action!
Cut-cutnya cukup cepat, pergerakan fightnya cukup cepat. Kita banyak ambil medium dan wide supaya keindahan koreografinya juga terlihat.
Itu nyesek itu.
We're still learning as we go along how to make these films, how to do action films. We cut it together and then we'll discuss and we'll figure out, okay, maybe this angle is right for this shot, but then how do we get to our next position? So we look for every possible flaw and every possible positive that we can find in terms of the scene. We had to consider a lot of different things during post-production, one of which was the duration of the film.
Action!
So one of the things that was in the development stages of The Raid was to kind of make this much more streamlined and much sort of faster paced. And so I kind of had, when I first started post-production on it, I had a key target to reach around about 80 to 85 minutes maximum. Then on the first assemble edit, it came in at around about 1 hour 55. So I knew then that it was never going to be sort of just, it was never going to reach my original target. So then after sort of doing a lot of fine tuning, a lot of editing, and then we managed to bring it down to around about 100 minutes total then at the end of the final offline cut of the film.
I think once we were able to start assembling those scenes together with some of the, you know, some of the other character moments and dramatic moments, we were able to help Gareth put it together in a way that would enable the film to be ready in time for Toronto in September, which under their post-production schedule wasn't very easy. So basically, while Gareth was still in production, we were advising Gareth day to day on these sequences.
Post production proses semuanya dilakukan di Siam Post Bangkok. Yang menjadi berbeda di film ini adalah color grading, pewarnaan. Karena story-nya cerita soal penyerbuan ke dalam gedung, di mana gedung itu kumuh, basah, gelap, dark gitu. Akhirnya kita putuskan untuk pewarnaannya lebih cenderung pucat, cenderung basah dan cenderung gelap. Setelah kita coba ternyata cukup nyaman dan kita anggap berhasil, Ya, kita kemas semuanya dengan warna yang berbeda pada kebanyakan film-film di Asia.
Post-pro is just as important as any other part of the filmmaking process. I mean, so much of the film comes alive when you're doing those final sort of touch-ups to the film. When you watch it, you can see certain areas working, but a lot of it is kind of, you know, still have to use your imagination, still have to kind of figure out how all of this is going to come into place at the end of the day. Because then you've got your online work, which is done by Andy, who did a fantastic job on enhancing all of the practical effects with sort of, you know, very subtle use of CG. And then obviously then the really, really complex sound mix that we had in place then by Fajar and Ogi as well.
Dari sisi sound design itu gue puas sama scene yang spy hole gitu, karena itu di situ kita harus menciptakan suasana ketegangan bahwa polisinya terpojok gitu ya. Itu lumayan rumit.
Wicking sih lebih.
Di sana kita harus rekaman foley lagi. Kita harus ngisi sound effects lagi, kayak contohnya suara tembakan polisi gitu. Kita coba beberapa kali tuh nggak bagus-bagus gitu. Akhirnya wah kayaknya sih harus bikin dari nol nih gitu suara senjata polisi gitu.
Ciri khusus pengennya memberikan kayak perasaan terhimpit gitu, sempit sama garang sih.
Di merantau kita masih banyak pakai organik, suara-suara organik, jadi kayak gitar akustik. Terus kita pakai djembe juga gitu, masih ada suara drum lah gitu ya. Tapi kalau di drive kita mau coba untuk full elektronik musiknya gitu.
Sebenarnya kita berusaha bereksperimen, bereksplorasi dengan musik kita sendiri untuk menciptakan gaya baru.
Ada satu scene khusus karena di situ kita ingin menggambarkan suasana yang chaotic banget gitu. Jadi instead of kita mainin nada gitar konvensional kayak misalnya nada gitar konvensional, kita cuman memberikan noise yang sangat chaos gitu. Misalnya contohnya kayak gini, suaranya ya hanya suasana chaotic itu kayak misalnya. Jadi nggak ada satu nada khusus gitu.
I tend to think of myself as the audience. What do I want to watch when I'm seeing this movie as well? If I start making something to be like, you know, something that somebody else would like but not me, then like I'm not the right person to be making that film then. So I always kind of try to keep it's what I want to see in the film then. And hopefully there are enough people who are like-minded or enough people who are sick enough that they like watching the same films that I watch.